Time to relive some childhood trauma. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Let's Play Bucky O'Hare. Oh, boy. Bucky O'Hare and his crew, Blinky, Deadeye, Jenny, and Willy, fight to save the Anniverse from the Toad Menace. One day, a transport bringing Bucky's crew to the Righteous was attacked. The Toads kidnapped Bucky's crew. Blinky is a captive on the Green Planet. Deadeye is sent to the Red Planet. Jenny is held at the Blue Planet. Willy is held on the Yellow Planet.
Ha ha ha! Bucky O'Hare, your friends are mine! You are next!
Bucky escaped the Toad Armada by a hair's whisker. Now he must save his loyal crew from enslavement by the terrible Toads. And then we're just thrown to the level select. This game is a little bit like Mega Man in its structure to start, but there's not really weaknesses you get. You're kind of meant to play through these stages in order of like left to right as well, starting up here in the Green Planet. To start, Bucky doesn't have a lot of health or even power. Thankfully, Green Planet's a pretty good starting level for this just because there's so many life up tokens and power up tokens to get along the way. Life is pretty straightforward. It's your health. You take a couple of damage points from anything you hit. Grabbing a heart will increase that by about 50%, and you max that out at twice its natural size. But if you get a game over, it returns back to its initial size. Although, thankfully, in this game, continues are unlimited, so you can just keep trying and trying and trying until you win. Power, though, is a little more complicated. Every one of the five playable characters, actually, has a different use for the power meter. For Bucky, you press and hold the B button, it builds up, and then you release it at max to do a higher jump. But the thing is, power needs to be raised with basically every character before it's really useful, and you do that by finding power-up tokens that are closer to little one-up coins and point coins that you find throughout the level. So you can max that up, I think, at like 3 or 4 times its normal size, and you get to, like, with Bucky, for instance, jump almost like half the height of the screen. It's pretty kind of ridiculous, honestly. With that said, Bucky himself doesn't have a lot of controls. He jumps, he moves left and right. You can press up and shoot to aim, and you can shoot downwards, but you can only do so while jumping, so I frequently forget you can do that. As for my own history of Bucky O'Hare, I call it childhood trauma for a reason. This was a game we had from when I was a baby, because my brother got it at some point during the NES's life cycle. And I just constantly tried to beat this as a kid. The furthest I got consistently was the first level after the 4 starting levels. But that took years to get even that far. Because the thing was with Bucky O'Hare, enemies do a fair amount of damage to begin with. But everything else can basically kill you in one shot. For instance, this ankle-deep water, instant kill. Hits, instant kill. Sometimes very weird hazards, instant kill. And you don't have a lot of lives to start, and after a continue, you even have less. You'll only have 3 lives in that case, because 0 counts in this game. You could die so quickly that it can genuinely jump scare you in some cases, and that part just didn't gel well with me as a kid too well, and it didn't to this day. The first time I beat this was actually me dedicating myself to finally doing it for an LP. I went, alright, I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna sit down one night and just try my best to beat it. And I did! And, it was arguably not even that worth it. This is pure wish fulfillment for young me. Which means that means it's time for me to clearly also try to beat the Rocky and Bullwinkle game on Game Boy. Ugh. This screen in particular is really annoying if you're trying to get any of the items, by the way, because you're just not gonna know they're there until you die and try the screen over again, which is unlikely, because if you already grabbed every life up along the way, unless you got a game over, you got plenty of health. This screen I definitely remember dying on a lot as a kid because I just tried to rush through the lasers instead of waiting, because the way the Toad ships on this screen work is the green lasers get fired directly in front of you at a pace that if you move when they get fired, you're gonna get hit by them no matter what. And their pellet fire comes out, feels like semi-randomly, honestly. But then it's time for our first boss here. I believe this name is meant to be Toadborg. Toadborg will pick up a heavy rock, throw it at you, and if you dodge it, he'll charge left and right, causing rocks to fall from the screen. You can only damage Toadborg from behind, though, so you need to jump over him and then shoot him when he's charging left and right. But be careful of the giant rock, because if the giant rock hits you before it shatters, it is an instant kill. there are going to be better ways to damage bosses down the line, but for right now, all we have is Bucky's pea shooter, and it's not very effective against bosses, although it does like to stay at a good distance compared to some of the other characters' weapons. This boss isn't hard, but it can be tense since you have to stick so close to it at the start to jump over any of its rocks. And that's stage one. Stage one for me. It could be stage whatever for you. Not too hard. It's easily the safest of the starting levels because there's not a lot of bullshit in the way.
Thank you, Captain. I've rescued a toad weapon that will smash walls of ice and stone. It was also acts as a rocket pack, Captain O'Hare, allowing you to fly.
By the way, Blinky here, voiced by Sam Vincent back in a one-season cartoon that lasted about 2 months. So he's voiced by Double D from Ed, Edd n Eddy. So, whenever you rescue one of your crew members, Bucky doesn't gain their abilities. You gain that character as someone you can switch to by pressing select. In this case, Blinky's attacks moved in a downward arc, but can destroy certain obstacles. And if you charge up his power meter, he gets a slight hovering ability that allows him to travel further distances rather than higher distances. I tend to stick as Blinky a lot just because there's so many times where smashing blocks comes in handy, but the annoying thing is, you have to build up each of their power meters individually, so make sure you don't accidentally grab a power token with a character that already has a full power meter. Bucky O'Hare here. This particular game is one of two games based off of a one-season cartoon that itself was based off a graphic novel slash comic line that I have never read. I've only seen like maybe one episode of the cartoon over the years. It didn't last long. If memory serves from my research for this LP, it lasted from like September to December of 91, if even. And there were some pretty big voice actors in it. Like I said, Blinky's voiced by Sam Vincent. Deadeye was voiced by Scott McNeil, who a lot of Transformers fans would recognize as Rat Trap alongside other characters from Beast Wars on. Bucky himself in that, notably voiced by Jason Mitos, who I remember most as being, I think his name was Zack, one of the twin dragons from Dragon Tales, the one that was with Wheezy, I think was the other one's name. And basically all the voice actors reprised their roles in the arcade Bucky O'Hare game, which was closer to a lot of Konami's beat-em-up games at the time on arcade, like Simpsons and all that. Although Bucky has a gun, so the beat-em-up nature of it kind of goes by the wayside a lot of the time. I might tackle the arcade game at some point, I don't know. Now, Red Planet, definitely a more dangerous level than Green Planet, if only because there's a lot more instant kill around. Basically, any kind of fire is instant kill, barring these lava plumes and fireballs. The lava plumes will do about a third of my health at the moment, so be careful of that all the same. What makes this level a little dangerous to tackle first is you're required to use Bucky's jump down the line to escape an instant death scenario, and you need that bar down there to basically be maxed to get around it at least like two-thirds of it. And if you're not picking up the power-up tokens, you're getting game overs along the way and not giving them to the right characters, you might get screwed out of being able to beat the stage at that point. This game is hard. The Infinite Continues does make it approachable, but I tore my hair out of this game as a kid. Now, I've never read the comic, but I did do some research into it beforehand. The comic actually didn't run for that long. It was only like 16 issues total, apparently, and that compiled into a graphic novel, which then got the cartoon. The comic was co-created by Larry Hama and Michael Golden. Larry Hama is probably most nowadays notable for being the lead writer for the G.I. Joe Marvel comics that Hasbro made in the 80s to tie into that toy line alongside the Transformers ones they made. Whereas Michael Golden, I believe, did some scattered Marvel work overall. Notably, I think he is the co-creator of Rogue and X-Men, so I think for X-Men is probably where he spent most of his time. I would probably have to ask my brother that, though, because he's definitely better versed on Marvel comics than I am. My comic books growing up were Sonic and that Archie Mega Man comic when that ran, and I still have to try to get into the IDW Sonic comics because I like the original character designs. Like, when it came to comic books, I very much just kind of grabbed whatever looked interesting. Like, I have scattered a lot of Spider-Man, a couple of Fantastic Fours, a lot of Batman. Sonic was probably the most dedicated one overall, though, if only because I was subscribed to Archie for that period. Like, I think I have the entire Sonic X run, most of Sonic Universe, and stuff like that. Like, I spent most of my time as a kid collecting and playing video games rather than doing a lot of reading. Although, I did read a lot back in, like, elementary school, middle school, but that was, like, reading full novels rather than graphic novels or comics. And that's because I was one of those kids that started reading late, but then skyrocketed ahead for several years in my reading level, but then didn't really do much with that in high school because I just got distracted with so many other things. Then I started again back in college and then got distracted again. There is a good pile of 9-10 books just next to my bed that I still have to try to read. Admittedly, if I ever pick up a comic book, I read through that shit moment one, like when I picked up The Rocketeer finally a couple of years back and read through that. Here's where things can get rough. You need to use Bucky's jump to get on top of or around this giant green boulder. And you need to remember when to get off, because sometimes you need to in order to get on smaller rocks because of the instant kill spikes all over the place. Sections like this on a first playthrough are a lot of trial and error, and it's rough. I remember as a kid, this was the level I would always try to tackle last, but nowadays I think it's honestly best to tackle this second, because you can stock up some lives between this and Green Planet and just hopefully have it ready for the next couple levels. With that said, time for a boss, the giant green orb, the Toad Sentinel. It will rest on the right side of the screen, throw a ball, and fire some lasers at you outside of the toad that's piloting it and the gun on its arm. Standing either right next to it or just off to the side of the next to it is the best way to dodge that bouncing orb, although you could just absorb the hits if you're in full health because it doesn't do much damage to begin with. After a little bit, it'll roll left and right across the screen a couple times. Be careful of this particular phase, because if you don't charge up your jump properly, it will crush you against the side of the screen and kill you. And then it rinses and repeats. This is a boss that you might want to wait until later to tackle in some regards, because one of the characters in particular's ability can just kind of melt through its HP bar, but we'll talk more about that in a few moments. Also, they do restore your health between stages, even though that doesn't matter much. Deadeye, here's a Toad Blaster, which I just lifted from a Toad arsenal. It was no problem zapping around in this Toad rocket pack. Zoomed right over the Toad walls. Any other Toad-related paraphernalia you'd like to talk about, Bucky? I do think the dialogue changes depending on the order you go through the stages, but I don't really care to note a lot of that. For now, it's time for Blue Planet. I'd say this is probably the hardest of the four planets overall, if only because the game controls relatively sharply, but there is a bit of momentum to stopping in some cases. So when you add ice physics to that, alongside one of my least favorite platforming mechanics, period, things get a little rough here. With that said, you're going to be spending a lot of time as Blinky here, as you need him in order to get past the rocks. There might be a way to break these if you don't have him, but if there is, I don't remember what it is. But the real pain comes on the next screen. You can do these for about 3 or 4 screens in the stage, period. These are snakes lifted almost exactly out of Battletoads. They progress through the stage and make platforms, but they also try to trap you, and be careful, because touching their face is instant kill, and they will actively use that as a hazard against you in several places. It's rough. I don't like these screens. Deadeye can make them a little easier, though, because of his special ability. For one thing, Deadeye's main weapon is a little bit of a spread shot from Contra. It shoots a shot diagonally upwards and downwards from you and then forward. But if you charge up his power meter, he jumps up and it doesn't look like much changes. But when he's flashing, you can actively grab and climb walls, which in some ways makes areas like this a little easier. In some ways, they actually want you to down the line, but I find it really iffy at the start because you have such low power with him, and because of the level order I tend to go in, I don't have a lot of power to use for him early on, so I tend to save him for the later game. On this screen, you want to be careful, by the way, because whenever you see a toad that's on the water's surface, they can shoot upwards and melt the platforms you're on. Be careful. You're especially going to need to be careful on the screen after this, because I'd argue it's the hardest screen out of the four starting levels, really, barring maybe the lava chase back on Red Planet. Because we have, like, a good minute-long-ish auto-scroller here, with enemies coming from all directions. And that plane occasionally drives by, destroying about a fifth or sixth of the platform at a time, meaning you're dodging and weaving past all the enemies. It's gonna have to get a lot tighter as you go through. And if memory serves, on hard mode, this is especially rough. I forget how you unlock hard mode off the top of my head. I forget if it's like a password or if you just need to beat the game and then try again after that. But if memory serves, enemies either do increased damage on hard mode or are all instant kill. I forget the exact nature of it because I've only tried it once, and that was a long time ago. I remember watching some speedruns of it, though, and being extraordinarily impressed. From here, though, you once again need Blinky, because you need his ability to destroy blocks, less to destroy the blocks themselves, and more so, well, actually, no, you need to exactly destroy the blocks, but you need to destroy the blocks because of the toad on the top right throwing spike balls down. The spike balls destroy the platforms, allowing you to progress further into the level. Sometimes you just get some weird luck with this and you have to mash the button over and over again until the ice block actually gets through to where it needs to go. But the toads that are throwing ice blocks aren't that big of a threat, neither are these weird little ice shurikens that are tracking you down and do damage. Even on a lower health bar, they don't really do enough to be really threatening. What can be threatening, though, are rooms like this that have raising and lowering platforms, because their hitboxes are a little finicky, and they're almost always near spikes, so you just kind of need to hope you don't get smushed into things. Something that is a little weird about the game, though, is that it feels like enemies' health is very inconsistent. Like, sometimes enemies will die in, like, 1 to 2 shots of Bucky or Blinky's attacks. But a lot of times they take, like, 5 or 6, and the only real difference of the enemy type visually is what their weapon is. Like, that icicle-throwing toad has way too much health compared to, say, the toads that are hatching out of these eggs right out of Gemini Man's stage. It's weird. Also, make sure you destroy as many items as you can in a lot of rooms, because they often hide point items or extra lives behind them. Not that I know where they all are. With that, though, it's time for the boss of Blue Planet. This is Al Nugator. He's gonna jump up and down on the far right side of the screen, firing missiles at you that kind of alternate between high, medium, and low. But every time there's about a full tile width of water on the ground as it rises up, he'll jump up and freeze it, and you can get trapped in that, being forced to either be killed or take a lot of damage. So when you're about seeing the water at about the height of Bucky's gun, constantly jump, because otherwise you're gonna get frozen. You don't want that to happen. He's got a lot of health, and even if you have the way to get through boss's health more quickly, it's a little dangerous with how long you'd have to charge up, so just mash the button. It might hurt your finger a little bit, but it's worth it in the long run. This fight's a little rough, and especially as you get higher up, because those are spikes up there, so you need to really get good at short hopping. If I were to rank the difficulty from, like, easiest to hardest out of the bosses, I'd say it probably goes Red Planet, Green, Blue, Yellow. Although it's notable that basically all those bosses have waste instant kill you, which is pretty rough.
Aye, Captain. We can croak all the toads with my beam blaster and toad turbo ball.
Indeed she can. Jenny is easily the strongest character in the game.
But with that, I'm gonna need to end this off here. Thank you guys for watching, and in part 2, we're gonna head into the 4th of the main stages, Yellow Planet, and see where we get thrown into after that. See you guys then.